So there's a lot of talk of consolidation, disintegration, bankruptcy. What's going to be the difference between the winners and losers in the cannabis space?
I think the winners are those that have properly planned for not just the evolution of recreational adult use in Canada, but a global footprint reach. Those that have properly scoped out and their vision is in line with global countries going medical, eventually recreational. Those companies that have a real good understanding of where the U.S. is going, the CBD hemp farm bill followed by medical legalization across all states. Those companies that have the leadership and have the commitment to make things happen are going to be the winners. The losers are those that are complacent, are those that are barely surviving under the present medical, and once recreational comes with a lot of price pressures at a wholesale level, price compression and therefore lower margins, and their cost structures are too large. Their growing capacity, their growing cost per gram, those are going to be the losers.
I think by some estimates, and you'll know better than I will, that global, global marijuana at this point is estimated, medical marijuana, I should say, is estimated at approximately $1 billion US. How big do you think this will get?
Tenfold. And I say that because, and let me use an example. Early November, Germany restarts in the tendering process that they pushed the pause button on. So there is a country where it's somewhat semi-socialized medicine when it comes to medical cannabis. It's a very dynamic market, well-structured, mature. There's an example of a country that probably can be five times out of Canada just on the medical side. But then you go elsewhere. You go to Italy. The UK just announced medical cannabis as being allowed through their House of Commons and House of Lords. Huge, huge opportunities here. Again, back to winners and losers, the winners that have understood this, have already been in market, have already developed relationships and built their business plans on paper, mind you, until the eventuality of legalization for medical purposes. So it's a monster. It's a monster medically on a global basis.
In the meantime, here in Canada, day one and in the immediate future, I understand we'll be dealing with shortages. And you've been quoted as saying that we'll be dealing with shortages. What are some of the challenges, the reasons, I guess, why there are shortages?
Yeah. Well, unlike some of my competitors who have yet to convey this message, but I can tell you we all are having these growing pains. It's like a five-lane highway trying to merge onto a one-lane. It's very congested and a lot of stumbling blocks. Whether it's supply chain, it's harvest, it's labor, it's excise stamp, not necessarily Health Canada, but the adhesives that come with that, and every individual province has their own type of excise stamp. So when it comes to a lot of stuff coming together in a very short time frame, everybody was bound to have situational issues. Now, for us, our biggest issue was labor. We have now remedied that, so we're looking really good now. But I can tell you that in July and August, and even in the beginning half of September, labor was an issue. When you're trying to jam so many products, don't forget I've got five brands I'm launching this Wednesday. Probably on average 30 to 40 SKUs per brand. That's a lot of pre-rolls and grams in a bottle, to oils, to sprays. And it was not enough time.
Were you dealing with waste? I mean, if you're dealing with 100% crop, how much waste are you dealing with at that point?
Well, our waste isn't necessarily waste. We had the crop issue where we had to physically throw away thousands of plants because you couldn't harvest it. Again, labor at the time. This was back in early to mid-August situationally. It's been remedied now, but when you count on 50 new hires on a Monday and only eight are still with you on a Saturday, that's a problem. So you plan for everything properly. It's just a lot of bumps in the road. And like I said, every licensed producer is having situational issues, some controllable, some not. Aphria to my shareholders, we're very transparent and very communicating, pluses and minuses. So my colleagues, my other CEOs of competitors, when are they going to come out and clarify their situation? Because there's not one province that is happy with their supply chain from any of the licensed producers that they've awarded MOUs to, and in the last 4 to 6 weeks issued firm POs.
And I want to go back to something that you just mentioned in terms of that global footprint, which includes the U.S., because Aphria divested itself of assets in the U.S. So what is that plan going forward with the U.S.?
I'll go with your divestment definition. I prefer to say that we now are in full compliance with all Canadian and U.S. regulators when it comes to stock exchanges. We have not divested. We have, through a series of options with full compliance, moved aside off our balance sheet pursuant to a Price Waterhouse clean opinion to make all this happen properly. We have the right to pull that back if and when, let me rephrase it, when the TSX compliance and other U.S. regulatory bodies have approved it. So it's not mine on my balance sheet today, but I have the right to bring it back under the right circumstances. Mm-hmm. So the U.S. is very important. If shareholders understood all of the activities that Aphria is doing in terms of aligning our interests with the ultimate goal of being a very, very dominant player in the U.S. market, they'd be very, very happy with things that are happening.
I'm going to borrow a word from you, aligning. So a big component, I guess, for cannabis companies such as yourself is aligning yourself with these food and beverage companies. So there are all kinds of rumors that we hear in terms of different cannabis companies and food and beverage companies expressing interest in cannabis companies. How, and I guess on the heels of that, the stock goes up. So how are ordinary investors supposed to navigate that sector if any little rumor drives up a stock? How are they supposed to understand this?
Yeah, well, first of all, these investment bloggers that are out there in their own communities, there are some fairy tales and then there are stories. Very interesting sometimes if you read and start believing all of this stuff. I've had 5 different bed partners already by now. I know there was the Molson Coors, and I've already been quoted saying yes, we had entertained some dialogue with Molson. just it wasn't the right fit for us. It was to Hydropothecary, and good for them. Beer is an element of a potential cannabis infused product. But when you look at the opportunities of going mainstream, when you look at where the consumer demands are going to come from, it's much more than just beer. You should include wines. You know, your glass of red wine every night that you consume. Can you imagine if it's a Cab Sav without any calories, it's non-alcoholic and it's infused with, all the way to juices. To energy drinks, to post-recovery workout drinks. I call all those utility drinks. Very, very impactful. So are there opportunities of looking at leaders like Coke and Pepsi? Absolutely. They're industry dominant and have huge, huge footprints outside of the core carbonated beverages. We are always looking to areas and opportunities that benefit Aphria. And by that, I also mean Aphria shareholders. We will not jump into anything just to get a small spark plug to our stock price. We're here for the long term. You need to get to the next level. You need to get not just water soluble, but water soluble that's also a higher level of bioabsorption, where you can now infuse not just beverages, but certain foods. I mean, it goes on and on. And that's what some of these global leaders are investigating. And now that legalization is not an if but when, it's only 2 days away, I think you're going to see a lot more acceleration of conversations now that it's going to be fully legal in Canada.